إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهديه الله تعالى فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ونبيه ورسوله. All praise and glory belongs to Allah. We thank Him and we seek His help and His guidance and His pleasure and His forgiveness. And we seek protection, Allah, from the evil whispers of our souls and the evil consequences of our actions. For whomever Allah Azza wa Jal chooses to guide, no one can lead astray. And whomever Allah Azza wa Jal leaves astray, there is no one that can guide. And we testify that no one is worthy of worship but Allah, alone without any partners, the true supreme king. And that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was indeed his prophet and his servant and his messenger. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. O people of Iman, O believers, have the taqwa of Allah. Fear Allah and keep your duty to Allah in the manner that He deserves. And do not die except in a state of complete and total submission to Allah. Surrender to His laws by fulfilling them. And surrender to His destiny by accepting it. Complete and total submission to Allah in a state of Islam, a state of that submission and that surrender willingly to the King of Kings subhanahu wa ta'ala. After welcoming our brothers and sisters to the house of Allah Azza wa Jal, our appointment this afternoon bi-idhnillah will be a reminder with regards to what the experience of Iman is supposed to be like. How is Iman supposed to feel? And of course Iman, faith, is more experienced than it is explained. And it is more tasted than it is defined. But we want to just put some broad markers out there so we can check, is there more to our deen for us than we're experiencing? Is there something we're missing out on and it's right there in front of us? Is there more to it? And he told us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and our talk will basically revolve around this one hadith of Anas radiallahu ta'ala an in Bukhari and Muslim, wherein he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ثَلَاثٌ مَنْ كُنَّ فِيهِ وَجَدَ بِهِنَّ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. Three, meaning three qualities. Whomever they are found in, he has found through them the sweetness of Iman. He says, أَيَكُونَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِمْ مَا سِوَاهُمَا. The first of them, for Allah and His Messenger to be more beloved to that person than everything else. The second, he says, وَأَيُحِبَّ الْمَرْءُ لَا يُحِبُّهُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ. And that a person love another person, loving them for nothing but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَأَنْ يَكْرَهَ أَنْ يَعُودَ فِي الْكُفْرِ بَعْدَ إِذَا أَنْقَضَهُ اللَّهُ مِنْهِ كَمَا يَكْرَهُ أَنْ يُقْذَفَ فِي النَّارِ. And that a person hate to return to disbelief after Allah has rescued him from it, in the same manner that he would hate to be thrown into a fire. So from the ground up, inshallah, azza wa jal. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, three qualities, whomever has them will taste the sweetness of Iman. There's another narration that clarifies what the sentence means. And it says, لَنْ يَجِدَ طَعْمَ الْإِيمَانِ. A person will never find the taste of Iman unless they have these three qualities. Meaning the hadith isn't saying, these are three qualities, if you have them, you have Iman. If you don't, there are some other qualities you can find Iman through. No, three qualities meaning these three are absolutely necessary. You will not find Iman without them. They're irreplaceable. That's the first thing we need to say. And then he said, whomever has these three qualities, he will find through them halawat al-Iman, the sweetness of Iman. The ulama said, Iman is not actually sweet in the manner that we understand sweet, as sugar equals sweet, something in our taste buds. No, because Iman is not from this world. Iman, what Allah places in the hearts of those that He loves, this is the secret of Allah in His creation, that He places into the hearts of those that He loves. It's a glimpse of the hereafter. It is your ability to see the hereafter with your heart, with the eyes of your heart. And that's why Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah used to say, there is nothing in this world that could be compared to the enjoyment of the hereafter except the bliss of Iman. Except the bliss of what? Having Iman in your heart. It's not from this world. They said, so it was just called sweetness. Why? Because sweetness is the most pleasing taste that we know, that we can relate to in this world. Understood? Meaning, there are other tastes, some people like them and some people don't. Some people are into spicy, some people are not. It pleases some and not others. But sweetness, everyone understands sweetness. A person has to fight themselves to get away from sweetness. And the doctor has to tell him, no, you're a diabetic, be careful. No, no, be careful, you need to beware, you have this medical condition or that. Because we are bent on loving it. It is the most pleasing thing to us that is commonly understood. And that is the real meaning of his words, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not literally. But whoever finds them, he will find the most pleasing experience he can imagine in this world. That is what this meant. So three, whomever has them, and you will not find Iman without having them, and when you have them, you will find the sweetness of the Iman. The first of them, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أن يكون الله ورسوله أحب إليه مما سواهما. For Allah and His Messenger to be more beloved to a person than everything else combined. And this is not a task that is automatic. This is not a feeling that a person just has. Rather, this comes as a fruit of feeding your heart. The information and then the reminder about who Allah and His Messenger are, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because a person may ask, okay, I'm going to be honest with myself, as we should. I love Allah and His Messenger, but I can't honestly say that I love them more than I love my job, because I compromise my relationship with Allah and His Messenger for my job. I don't love them more than I love my family, because at times my family pulls me away from what Allah and His Messenger love. Honesty mandates that you make that diagnosis about yourself. So how can I now get to that level that they're more beloved to me than everything? We say, first of all, loving Allah, how does someone love Allah? We love Allah for two main reasons. Number one, who He is. And number two, what He did for us. Understood? So the first reason we love Allah is because who He is. The most perfect, the absolute supreme King, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That alone is enough of a reason to love Him, even if He didn't do anything for us. Even if He didn't promise us a reward in the hereafter. Even if He didn't threaten us with punishment in the hereafter. Even if He didn't create paradise and the hellfire. Simply who He is in and of itself is a reason to love Him. Why? Because that's the way Allah created us. He created us to love perfection, to love strength, to love justice, to love beauty, to love wisdom, and Allah Azza wa Jal is the epitome of all of that. He is the ceiling of all of that. So you can't help but love Him. You can't help but adore Him once you know who He is. So we have to know who Allah is and know what Allah does for us so that can cultivate the love of Allah inside of us. You can imagine Allah Azza wa Jal says in the greatest ayah in the Quran, Allahu la ilaha illa hu. Allah, none is worthy of worship with Him. Al-Hayyul Qayyum, the eternally living. The first who has no beginning. Al-Qayyum, the one that manages everything. Later on, Ayatul Kursi, Allah Azza wa Jal says, Man dhal ladhi yashfa'u 'indahu illa bi'idhni. Just quick remarks. Who is the one that intercedes? You know what intercession is, when you're supposed to get into a tight squeeze, you're about to be punished or otherwise, and someone steps in the middle and says, please let him go. That's shafa'ah, that's intercession. Allah says, who can intercede in front of Allah except with the permission of Allah? You know what that means? He's telling you, I don't owe anyone anything. And I will not need from anyone anything. Therefore, no one has a right to intercede on my behalf unless from my benevolence I let them. I say, okay, you can intercede. Greatness. The ayah continues, وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. His kursi has expanded wider than the heavens and the earth. The kursi, as Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, is مَوْضِعُ الْقَدَمْ. The kursi is the footstool, where someone puts their foot. You know, on the human level, a person has a seat, he has a throne, and then he has a footstool where he places his foot. Belonging to Allah, of course, is the highest description. This is not the throne of Allah. This is the footstool of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wider than the heavens and the earth. Brighter than everything above you. And you know, all that you know of this universe is nothing. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to us, وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّا السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِيحِ. We decorated the lowest skies with stars, lantern, these stars. So wherever there are stars, the closest of our stars is the sun, 93 million miles away. The all the universes and the stars they contain, this is the lowest heaven. This is all the lowest sky. And he said to us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this lowest sky to the second sky, the second heaven, is like the comparison of a ring in a desert. And the second, how massive, to the third is like a ring in a desert. And this goes on until the seventh heaven. And then the seventh heaven compared to the kursi, the footstool, not the throne, is like a ring in a desert. His kursi is wider than the heavens and the earth. Greatness. When a person comes to know who Allah is through his word and the words of his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this changes how you feel about Allah. You can't help but adore him. And then we said number two is what he does for you. And I'm not going to go far. Allah Azza wa Jalla teaches us in the Quran to remember the little things that are the great things in reality, but they are subtle. They are little that we overlook them. If you would just take a look and observe and recognize and reflect, you would fall head over heels in love with your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jalla says in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, أَفَرَأَيْتُمْ مَا تَحْرُثُونَ أَأَنْتُمْ تَزْرَعُونَهُ أَمْ نَحْنُ الزَّارِعُونَ. The things that you plow in the earth, wheat, bread, who considers what a blessing bread is? The stuff you plant in the earth, bread is just one of the many things we get out of the earth. He says, are you the ones that sow these seeds? You cause the seed to crack open and germinate and sprout? Or are we the ones that take care of this agriculture? And then he said subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next ayah, لَوْ نَشَاءُ جَعَلْنَاهُ حُطَامًا. If we wanted, we would have turned this into rubble. He didn't say, we're not going to let it come out of the ground. He's saying, if we wanted, we can even let it come out, and you see it right there, and then we cause it all to die in 1 second. Because it hurt. It's even more painful, even more humbling, when it's so close but so far. Understood? And then later on, a few ayat later, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ الْمَاءَ الَّذِي تَشْرَبُونَ. Haven't you seen the water you drink? أَأَنْتُمْ أَنْزَلْتُمُوهُ مِنَ الْمُزْنِ أَمْ نَحْنُ الْمُنْزِلُونَ. Did you send it down from the clouds, or are we the ones sent it down? Notice the words are all questions. Questions, their answer is obvious. I'm saying these are simple things. And this is called a rhetorical question. You could say, I'm the one who sent down from the clouds. Allah could have said that. But when he says, did I send it down? Or did you send it down? What's the difference between the statement and the question? The question, it's almost too embarrassing to answer. It humbles you. And that's the whole point of these subtle things. To humble you, saying, man, how can I have such a weak relationship with Allah? The point of the question is for you to lower your head. And then he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَوْ نَشَاءُ جَعَلْنَاهُ أُجَاجًا. We send it down, and if we wanted, he didn't say we won't send it down. If we wanted, we could send it down, but make it salty. Would you be able to drink it? That's even harder than us not getting it at all. You got it, and you can't benefit from it. This wording, once again, is to pull out of you that love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to devote yourself to Him with your heart before anything, before the physical actions that at times become mechanical in our lives, and we don't experience our iman, we don't love Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as they deserve to be loved. And then after providing all that for you, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْضَى مِنْ عَبْدِهِ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ الْأَكْلَةَ فَيَحْمَدُهُ عَلَيْهَا وَيَشْرَبُ الشَّرْبَةَ فَيَحْمَدُهُ عَلَيْهَا. Indeed, Allah accepts from you. Look how much He accepts from you. That you eat this meal that's so impossible for you to get on your own, the ayat mentioned. You eat a meal and you simply thank Him for it. Alhamdulillah. That's it. And then you have this drink and you thank Him for it. Allah is pleased with that. So He gives us so much and He accepts from us the little. Now you know how to love Him, who He is and what He does for us. How do we love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam? The same exact way. Knowing who He is sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and knowing what He did for you. Knowing who He is, that He was the greatest human being, and He was the greatest a human being could ever be, while still being a human being. Yes? He's still the creation of Allah, absolutely. But he was the greatest of the creation of Allah. And if you were to analyze his life just for a bit, it would be mind-blowing. The head of a state. A girl can take him into any route in Medina because she knows he won't say no. And then a man will walk up to him and ask him for something that he needs, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he won't say no. And then in battle, he doesn't send off the armies, he's the closest of them, as Ali radiallahu anhu says to the enemy. Sahih al-Bukhari, just to give you a detailed example, not just mention broad headlines, Hayth Sahl ibn Sa'd radiallahu ta'ala an, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, uhdiya ilayhi hulla, a garment was given to him as a gift, muhtajan ilayha, while he had a need for it. Because he used to take care of the needs of others, and put his needs last, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the head of the state. This is the collector of the zakah, the sadaqat. He was given a gift because he wouldn't accept sadaqah. Allah protected him from that and made him credible by him not taking from what he collects. And he enriched him with otherwise, with the jihad. He says, and he was given a gift that he needed. So a man from the Ansar said, Ya Rasulullah, ma ajmal hadhihi hulla, uksuniha. O Messenger of Allah, this hulla is very beautiful. How beautiful it is. Can I wear it? Can I have it? Give it to me. So the Prophet ﷺ takes it off and he gives it to him. And he leaves. The Sahaba, of course, were waiting for the Prophet ﷺ to leave so they could bite this guy's head off. And they said, how dare you ask the Prophet ﷺ for this when you know he needed it. And you know he doesn't get asked for anything and says no. He says, no, it wasn't out of disrespect. I know what I did. It wasn't out of disrespect or lack of consideration for the Prophet ﷺ that I did this, but I wanted this to be my kafan, my shroud that I get wrapped up and buried in. And he was, radiallahu ta'ala. But look at who he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Unreal, mind-blowing, if you would just learn about your Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then secondly, what he did for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا. Allah has conferred a great favor upon the believers by sending among them a messenger. From among them, يَتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِ, that recites to them the verses of Allah. You think it was easy for him to recite to us the verses of Allah? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the sacrifice it took to receive the wahi, that's one sacrifice. And then to deliver the wahi, that was another sacrifice. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ, and to purify them. He directed us to every ailment, and he liberated our minds to think, and he promoted knowledge and science and medicine and tolerance and all of this. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ, and he purified humanity. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ, and he taught them the book and the guidance, the wisdom, which is the most important of all. وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ, and before that they were in clear error. Humanity was lost. Humanity was in darkness. It was not easy for him to receive the revelation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As the Sahaba say, we used to see him sweating on a cold day, and we knew that wahi was coming down upon him, sallallahu rabbi wa salamu alayhi. And Zayd ibn Thabit, I was there in his house, and his leg was on top of mine, and then his leg became heavy. I realized he was receiving the revelation, and my thigh was going to burst from the weight of his thigh upon mine. And once, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's riding an animal, and the wahi comes down upon him, the animal buckled to its knees. It fell, it couldn't handle the weight from receiving the wahi. And then delivering it, the earth drank from his blood, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His mouth lost his teeth, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He grew white hair, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, delivering that wahi to us. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, cared more about us and worried more about us than we do about ourselves. And he stayed up at night for us and for our betterment, more so than we stay up for our own betterment. He stands up the whole night praying, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and saying, Rabbi ummati, ummati. Oh Allah, my ummah, my ummah. Oh Allah, my ummah, my ummah. And crying, and crying. When was the last time you ever got up in the night and said, Oh Allah, help me, and cry? Just for your own self. He would cry for us before we were ever born. Until Allah Azza wa Jalla sent Jibreel alayhi salam to tell him, Allah has heard your request for your ummah, O Muhammad, and he told me to tell you, إِنَّا سَنُرْضِيكَ فِي أُمَّتِكَ وَلَا نَسُوءُكَ, we will surely please you regarding your ummah, and we will not disappoint you. And that's why one of the Salaf, he used to say, that the most hopeful ayah in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this was his opinion, the most hopeful ayah in the book of Allah azza wa jal is the words of Allah in Surah Al-Duha, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Allah will give you and surely give you until you are pleased. He said, this is the most hopeful ayah in the book of Allah to me, because the Messenger of Allah will not be pleased with a member of his ummah in the fire. So once you know who Allah is and what He does for you, and who His Messenger ﷺ is and what He did for you, they will be at that moment more beloved to you than everything else. That's the experience of Iman, or the beginning of it at least. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ لِي وَلَكُمْ. الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. All praise and glory belongs to Allah alone, and His finest peace and blessings be upon the one after whom there is no prophet. Our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And of course we said that this is necessary for us all, because if we are honest, we will know that we do not love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam as we should. Nor do our children, nor do our families, and we are responsible for this in front of Allah. For ourselves first and those around us second. And a person can at times dismiss the question and say, no, I have unsurpassed love for Allah and His Messenger. And Allah Azza wa Jal blessed us with a gauge to measure our love for Him, so that we don't fool ourselves, because we're not going to be able to fool Allah. So He had mercy on us by throwing for us a measuring stick. In His Quran, He said to us, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Tell them, O Muhammad, if you really love Allah, then follow me. Follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allah will love you and forgive you your sins, and Allah is forgiving, merciful. Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah said about this ayah, زَعَمَ قَوْمٌ أَنَّهُمْ يُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَبْتَلَاهُمْ بِهَذِهِ الْآيَةِ. A bunch of people began claiming that they loved Allah, so he tested them with this verse. This verse was known among the early Muslims as Al-Rajifa, the earthquake, the Quaker. Why? Because it really shakes a person to say, wait a minute, forget this whole I love Allah and Allah loves me and God is love and all these things that many in humanity say, Muslim and non-Muslim alike. Do you obey Him or not? Do you want what He wants, or you prefer to live on your own terms and you just keep telling yourself you love Allah and His Messenger? So this is what separated true Iman from true disbelief, or true Iman from the Iman that was mixed with hypocrisy. So it shakes a person. Do I have hypocrisy inside of me? I don't obey Allah and His Messenger as I should. That means in reality I don't really love them as I should. Otherwise, no way you're going to love them and disobey them. As Abu Abdullah al-Mubarak rahimahullah used to say, أَتَعْصِ الْإِلَهَ وَأَنْتَ تُظْهِرُ حُبَّهُ هَذَا لَعَمْرِي فِي الْقِيَاسِ بَدِيعُ. You disobey your God while claiming, publicizing that you love Him. This surely in the scales of logic is something new. Meaning he's trying to say, I never heard anything like this before. You love Him and you're disrespecting Him. You love Him and you're disobeying Him. You're disappointing Him. He continues to say, إِن كَانَ حُبُّكَ صَادِقًا لَأَطَعْتَهُ. If your love was true, you would have obeyed Him. إِنَّ الْمُحِبَّ لِمَنْ يُحِبُّ مُطِيعُ. If you would have truly loved Him, you would have obeyed Him. Indeed, the lover is ever obedient to the one that he loves. That's the experience of Iman. You can't help it. You're afraid to miss out. And then we move on to the second very quickly. Allah and His Messenger to be more beloved than everything. Number two, He said sallallahu alayhi wasallam to love a person, not loving them for anything but Allah. Because that's automatic now. When Allah and His Messenger are more beloved to you than everything, they're the center of your life. The true believer brings people close and sends people away based on how beloved they are to Allah, how obedient they are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He comes together, meaning at heart, with those that are closer to Allah, those that sacrifice more for Allah. We can't judge the hearts, but we have to see people by what's apparent. What appears to be more beloved to Allah is going to be more beloved to me. Humans and actions. And the more distant someone is from Allah, the more distant they are from me. Humans and actions. That's the way it has to be. That's logic. How can I claim to love Allah and still be able to love someone who is defiant and disrespectful to Allah? So the believer is like that. He can love someone more than he loves his own family because he sees that this someone is closer to Allah than his family. And this is the difference between love and mercy in reality. We have mercy for everyone, for our family and our non-family, and the Muslims and the non-Muslims, and the humans and the animals, yes. But our love is for Allah and His Messenger and the believers. Understood? The closer they are to believe Iman with their deeds, the closer they are to us. And this, wallahi, was of the most beautiful aspects of the early Muslims. He would not know his Muslim, or his name, or where he lived, and he would hear about him that he was a good, righteous person, he would love him. This is the way we should be. When we hear about a scholar or read his book somewhere, something he dedicated to the deen, we should love him and seek nearness to Allah by loving him. And when a Muslim is going through a difficulty somewhere, I feel like I'm going through it myself. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he used to hear that a place in the Muslim lands received rain after there was drought. He would make sajda and shukr. He would prostrate to Allah, thanking him for the rain that they received, as if he was the one that needed the rain, and he's the one that just received it. In the Hijrah, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an says, and I kept insisting that the Messenger of Allah drink when they were finally given some milk. I insisted that he drink first and keep drinking. He says, فَشَرِبَ حَتَّى رَضِيتْ. And he drank until I was satisfied. Because that's how much you're supposed to love your brother. Love your brother until you say, oh me, until you're one and the same. You are a single body, as he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You love for your brother what you love for yourself. And this is a beautiful statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No one has iman until they love for their brother what they love for themselves. Why? Because now you don't need a checklist. You don't need a book to know what are the rights of my brothers and sisters in Islam. Surely there are rights. Prophet ﷺ said the rights of a Muslim and a Muslim are six. When he dies, you pray on him, and when he's sick, you visit him, when he invites you, you respond to him whenever capable, right? He sneezes, you say, Alhamdulillah, he says, Alhamdulillah. He greets you, you say, Wa alaykum salam. These are his rights. But these are not his only rights. Understood? He called them rights, meaning these are absolutely necessary. Don't forget about these. These are an absolute must. But he gave us a general rule. He said, love for your brother what you love for yourself. Don't check how haram and how halal, how do I have to. Would you love it for yourself? Then love it for your brother. Would you hate it for yourself? Hate it for your brother. Ibn Rajab, rahimahullah, he says something also very beautiful about this hadith that I just wanted to throw in there. He says, and loving for your brother what you love for yourself includes you not accepting and not liking except that your brother is better than you. Why? He said, because you're not supposed to be satisfied with how religious you are. You should be higher. Therefore, you should be happy that your brother becomes better than you in religion as well, because that's what you love for yourself. It should pain you to see your Muslim brother distant from the deen or struggling with his religious commitment. You want him to be better than you if you really love him, and love for him what you love for yourself, until you become one body. As he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the example of the believers, they are like one body. They feel for one another. When one part is sick, the rest hurts and loses sleep, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Sulaiman al-Darani, rahimahullah, used to say, إِنِّي لَأُطْعِمُ اللُّقْمَةَ أَخًا مِنْ إِخْوَانِي فَأَجِدُ طَعْمَهَا فِي حَلْقِي. Indeed, I give one of my brothers a morsel of food and I find its taste in my throat. He's not really tasting the food, his brother's eating it. He's tasting the sweetness of Iman. Understood? He's tasting the effects of being one with his brother. This was a reality at one point in time when the basis of brotherhood was truly Iman. No other factor. Nothing but Iman. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the third point, and to hate to return to disbelief after Allah rescued you from it, the same way you would hate to be thrown into a fire. This is part of what Iman is supposed to feel like. A person who has Iman automatically is worried about his Iman. So when you are not afraid for your Iman and concerned for your Iman, then you have not reached that level of the sweetness of Iman yet. Because part of it is you valuing that Iman and you're so afraid to be disconnected from it. You're so afraid to fall into disbelief. How can I fall into disbelief? One way is for you to approve of it. Because approving of disbelief is disbelief. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى. Whomever denies, rejects الطاغوت, the false gods, the devils, and whatever the devils call to, and believes in Allah alone, then they have held on to the firmest handhold, which is La ilaha illallah, which is the statement of Iman. You cannot be a believer until you disbelieve first, disbelief in everything else meaning. That's why our deen begins with that. La ilaha. There's no God illa Allah, except Allah. This, it is not that you believe in Allah. There are others outside that believe in Allah as well. But you, what makes you who you are is that you disbelieve in everything else. And you're afraid to get caught dead associating partners with Allah. You're worried to fall into it without even trying. And once again, this is a fruit of loving Allah and His Messenger more than everything. You know when you love someone, you're worried to miss out on the one that you love. And you take 1,001 precautionary measures to make sure you meet your appointment with the one that you love. And when a guy loves a girl, he takes a shower, puts on his best clothes, and rehearses what he's going to say, and then he shows up early, and then he's checking, wait, where is she, what's going on, she didn't show up, she's just a minute late, no, maybe I'm in the wrong place, maybe I should check the other corner. He's worried to miss out on the one that he loves. This is on a human level. What about when Allah and His Messenger are more beloved to you than everything else? You become worried automatically to approve disbelief, to fall into disbelief. You are afraid to sin. Because sinning is the stepway to disbelief. That's why the companions who committed such few sins were so afraid of their sins. They knew that they did more good deeds, but they were afraid that sin would come back and haunt them before they die, and they would lose Iman the last moment. That worriness is part of the experience of Iman. It makes you cry, but not regular kind of crying. Tears that give you clarity. Tears that are part of Iman, an experience that's outside of this world. Isn't it strange how the more a person's iman increases, the more afraid he becomes? This is the way it's supposed to be. But you would think logically, no. I'm supposed to have more iman, so I'm more secure. I'm closer to Allah, so I'm not going to be punished. But the most amazing thing is that the more iman a person has, the more he values that iman is afraid to lose it. Because the person that doesn't believe in anything, what's there to worry about? I don't believe it exists. Understood? Allah Azza wa Jalla says, قُلْ هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا. Perhaps you've heard this verse before. Shall I not inform you of the biggest losers with regards to their deeds? Those that wasted their efforts in this world while assuming that they're doing good works. Imagine that. They get shocked in the end that it was all a waste. Every believer is afraid of that ayah. And every hypocrite's like, no, nothing to do with me, don't worry. Because that's what Iman is. Iman makes you worry to miss out on it. Worry to jeopardize your relationship with Allah. Worried of anything that could subject you to that. As Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah used to say, Al-Mu'minu jama'a ihsanan wa shafaqa. Wal-Munafiqu jama'a isa'atan wa amna. Sahih al-Bukhari is recorded, Al-Hasan said, the believer is someone who does good deeds and he's afraid at the same time. Whereas the hypocrite is the one that does evil deeds and he secures. It's fine. Because that's exactly what disbelief is. Lack of Iman is just that. You don't see clearly anymore. So you're not afraid. And I seek forgiveness from Allah for describing all of these emotions at once that I am so distant from. But we need to first put some markers out there to identify where is our Iman. The experience of Iman, again, to close the khutbah, is to love Allah and His Messenger more than everything. For them to become the center of your life. And as a result, you will be engaging yourself and humanity based on how close and far they are, their proximity or distance from Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as well, you will become more and more afraid, more and more worried as your iman climbs. And that is the greatest thing you can prepare for the Day of Judgment. That iman. As Allah Azza wa Jal said, يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتِ. Allah raises those that have iman amongst you and those that have knowledge, many levels. And of the ulama, they used to say, so the greatest thing you can come out of this dunya with is iman to save you. And then knowledge on top of your iman to raise you in your levels. But you need that iman. And they say that any blessing that you value, any favor that you have, you always check up on it. Any of those favors, they are relative. They could be for you or against you. Everything. Your money, your children, your spouse, anything could be for you and could be against you. Except one thing in this whole universe. It's called iman. That is for you and for you and for you, it will only bring you benefit. So do you check up on it the way you check up on your bank account? Do you check up on it the way you check up on your health every few months? A person needs to understand the experience of iman and how serious the matter is to chase after it and become worried about it. And once again, that is the door to being saved and enjoying the sweetness of iman here and freedom from the fire in the hereafter. I'll leave you with one hadith, the hadith of Shaddad radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reported that Allah, the Mighty and Majestic, said, وَعِزَّتِي وَجَلَالِي لَا أَجْمَعُ لِعَبْدِي خَوْفَيْنِ وَلَا أَمْنَيْنِ I swear by my might and my majesty, I will never combine for any one of my slaves two fears or two securities. إِنْ هُوَ خَافَنِي فِي الدُّنْيَا أَمَّنْتُهُ يَوْمَ أَجْمَعُ فِيهِ عِبَادِي If he fears me in this world, I will grant him security on the day that I gather my slaves back to me. وَإِنْ هُوَ أَمِنَنِي فِي الدُّنْيَا خَوَّفْتُهُ يَوْمَ أَجْمَعُ فِيهِ عِبَادِي And if he feels secure of me in this world, I will strike fear in him on the day that I resurrect my slaves. So may Allah make us of those that taste the sweetness of Iman and love our brothers only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and make us of those that are fearful of Him, truly fearful of Him subhanahu wa ta'ala and concerned about our Iman. Allahumma ameen. Allahumma aghfir lana hazlana wa jiddana wa khata'ana wa amdana wa kullu thalika indana. Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub thabbit qulubana ala deenik. Ya musarrif al-qulub sarrif qulubana ala ta'atik. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا اللهم أحي قلوبنا بالإيمان وجدد الإيمان في قلوبنا نسألك يا ربنا إيمانا لا يحتز ولا قيلا لا يتردد اللهم إنا نسألك أن نخافك كأننا نراك ونسألك شوقا إلى جنتك يعادل شوق من عاينها اللهم آمين اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك على عبدك ونبيك ورسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والحمد لله رب العالمين